So what I'd like to do is, again, just give a fair introduction to our next speaker, Professor Sam Madden. I'm going to draw your attention to the bios in here. I'm not going to read everything for Professor Madden, but I did want to mention a few things. Professor Madden is a professor of electrical engineering and computer science at MIT's CSAIL, and CSAIL stands for Computer Science and Artificial Intelligence Laboratory. He leads the big data at CSAIL. And as you read through this, it's very impressive, all the awards that he's gotten. So Professor Madden's really been on the cutting edge for quite a while. He's was named one of the Technology Review's top 35 under 30 in 2005. And he's received numerous awards from the NSF, the Sloan Foundation, and best paper awards from a number of different organizations. So in his time here at MIT, he's got a really storied career, and it's really on issues that are central and for all of us. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to you, Professor. Thank you very much for coming today.
Thanks, Jim. Thanks, everybody, for coming. It's great to be here. You can tell that I'm kind of from a different community because I look around the room and you're all dressed better than I am. So this is dressing up for those of us in the technology business. So I really am a computer scientist. I work on software to manage data. And I've been running a couple of organizations that are in the quote-unquote big data space. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what I think big data means from a technology perspective and some of the cool technologies that we're building at MIT that hopefully are relevant to you guys and the work that you do. I decided to focus the talk really on technology today and not try and push myself too far into the business world, but I'd love to have a conversation with you guys about how some of the technologies we're talking about relate to the things that you do. Definitely interrupt, ask questions, and there should be time at the end to take a bunch of questions. So you guys all probably have heard the term big data. I think at the highest level, this big data craze, for me, coming from the software world of managing data, big data is actually a little bit mystifying because we're still doing the same things we've been doing when we build software to manage data after over all these years. So suddenly everybody's just as obsessed with the idea of data, the idea of managing and collecting data. And I think at the heart of it is really this realization that we have data about everything that we do. Suddenly we have sensors, we have phones, we have really powerful computer systems that can collect massive amounts of data just about everything. And I'm sure that's true in your guys' business in spades. And so, everybody is realizing that there's value to be gotten from this data, and they're sort of desperately struggling to figure out how they get that value out of their data. So you guys probably have all heard these three Vs before: the volume, velocity, variety. This is kind of the canonical definition that people give when they talk about what is a big data problem. You've got a lot of data. You've got data that's coming at you really fast, faster than your systems can handle. You've got data coming from all over the place, and you don't know how to integrate it together. From the sort of traditional software perspective, actually these volume and velocity problems, they're not really new problems. I mean, we've been working on building tools to process ever-increasing amounts of data. And some of my background is in the conventional, boring relational databases world. And we've got systems there that can manage petabytes of information. If what you have fits neatly into a tabular relational kind of format, you can cram it into your favorite relational SQL-based database system, and it will happily process it on hundreds of nodes up to petabytes of data. The new challenges really, I think, come in this variety space. You've got data coming from all over the place. It's no longer this plain tabular data that's easy to stick in a computer system and make sense out of. I think there's a couple of other challenges that come, and I'm not going to try and cram them in this V rubric, but two that I think are particularly sort of challenging are, first of all, one of the things you see when you start to talk to people about their data processes are that they have this very human-intensive, very labor-intensive process for making sense of data, which just doesn't scale as data volumes go up. So I'll give you an example of this in just a minute, but it's this sort of thing like, for every record, sticking every piece of information, somebody has to put it in some Excel spreadsheet. And that may not sound like big data, but the truth is that a lot of the problems that people have with managing data are really related to individuals having to do some work with the data. The other thing that's happened is that there's a recognition that there are these very compute-intensive algorithms that people want to run. So some of the machine learning tools, these things like classifiers and clustering algorithms, don't scale linearly with the size of the data, but they scale sort of quadratically or even cubically with the size of the data. And when you're talking about billions of data points, that causes problems, and we need new platforms to help sort of mitigate some of those compute-intensive challenges. So that's the broad brush, like what is big data? I thought I'd give you a couple of examples that I think are interesting examples that to kind of make this a little bit more concrete. So the first example is one from a colleague, a friend of mine named Jim Michelson, who works at the Mass General Hospital. He claims to have assembled the world's largest cancer patient database. I don't know if this is true, but it's a big patient database, about 173,000 patients. And it's a kind of an interesting data set because it's cross-linked in all sorts of ways. So it's connected to this thing called the National Tumor Registry that gives you information about the sizes and shapes of the tumors of patients. It's cross-linked with the death registry when patients die, so you know when they died and what their stated cause of death was. And it's also linked with a whole bunch of other stuff like billings, the lab information from the labs, imagery if it exists, genetic information. So it's this really massive and pretty cool data set. And Jim was interested in answering a specific question on this data, which had to do with costs. So when he went to look at the cost of treating a lung cancer patient, just focusing on lung cancer here, he found something pretty interesting, which is that if you look at the top 10% of patients, you can see, you may not be able to read this, but the median cost to treat the top 10% of patients is $69,000, okay? And the median cost to treat the 50th percentile, the median patient, was $12,000. So there's a factor of five difference here between the least expensive and most expensive patient. Can anybody guess what's different about these patients? So somebody heard somebody say stage, somebody said how long they're in care. So it turns out that actually, at least according to Jim, when he went and looked at all these variables that you might think are correlated, maybe, you know, does the person have insurance? How long is the person, you know, in the hospital? What's the stage of presentation? How old is the patient? Are there complicating risk factors? That those things essentially are pretty uniform across these two groups. And what he actually found, which was a little bit surprising, is that the thing that, well, somebody, so I told you a bunch of things it's not. Somebody else want to take another guess about what it might be? Sometimes people figure this out.
Location.
I think that these are all patients at the Mass General Hospital, so. Okay, so some of these things are, I don't know whether he knows that information. He says it's not correlated with whether or not they have insurance anyway. So it turns out that if you have one of three doctors, Jones, Smith, or Roberts at the Mass General Hospital, no, not their real names, right, then you have a much higher probability of being in this most expensive bucket, okay? Why is that? Because these patients, these patients are, these doctors are, they're doing what they think is the right thing. They're just doing something that's different than all the other doctors. So a natural question is to ask whether these patients in this most expensive bucket are getting better with a higher probability. It turns out they're not. Lung cancer is really not a very good disease, and most people ultimately don't survive. And so it's a disease where probably being a little bit, not over-treating is probably the right thing to do, because there's no sense in giving these patients way more medicine than they need if they're not going to survive anyway, at least when you look at the, statistical averages. So I like this example because I think it's an interesting example. It's not the world's largest database. By database sizes, there's not actually probably that much data here. But when you talk to Jim about how he derived this insight, this is an example of this human intensive thing. He literally had he or one of his interns, basically running regression after regression after regression on this data set in order to find and discover this pattern. It was a very labor intensive thing. It took him months of work to discover this one fact in this data set. And I think a lot of what big data is about for me is trying to build tools that make it much easier to come to these kinds of insights. So I'm going to tell you about one tool that does this a little bit later today. The other one I want to talk, the other quick example I want to give you is this flight prediction example. This is probably, since you guys are supply chain folks, you probably have thought about problems like this, even if you haven't thought about flight prediction. I think flight prediction is an interesting one. So this is specifically the problem of, what are the delays going to, how do we predict delays for planes, right? And I like this because it's a very simple problem. You can see the value of it. Like, can we predict whether, say 24 hours in advance, whether a given flight is going to be delayed or not, right? when you start thinking about this problem, it's a really, really, really hard problem because you have all these different data sets. You've got some historical information, you've got weather data, you have, you know, maybe information about the other concurrent flights, right? You have these kind of data sets that all have to be integrated together in order to answer this question. And it's just not obvious how you combine these data sets together in order to solve this. And this problem is further complicated by the fact that you might say, oh, there's some historical ground truth which actually tells us, you know, what things look like. But when you go to look at historical data, this is due to a colleague of mine named Luna Dong, if you go look at these sources of historical data, I mean, the airlines may have some canonical reference source, but as a third party, if you wanted to build a tool that predicted delays, you would go look at some historical sites. And you go look at, say, maybe some websites, like here's three, FlightView, FlightAware, and Orbitz, for the same flight, flight number 118, American Airlines. If you look at this same flight, you see some pretty weird things. So the scheduled departure time is actually different between these three things. So one says it was, two of them say it was 6:15, and one says it was 6:22. Okay, so even the scheduled time disagrees. And then you look at these other things, like the the scheduled, the estimated arrival time, 9:40, 8:33, and 9:54. I mean, these systems are, I mean, who knows what's going on in these systems, right? They're doing some internal algorithm that tries to do the prediction, or some of them are reporting the actual scheduled time instead of the estimated time. I mean, who knows what's going on, right? But these kinds of inconsistencies, you know, when you start to look at real data sets, are incredibly common, and they're incredibly hard to deal with. And building tools that can integrate these diverse sets of data across multiple systems, as I'm sure those of, you know, supply chain has got to be full of these. You've got hundreds of little systems that are each sort of tracking, you know, the flow of goods through, you know, all different parts of the world. I mean, that's, that problem has got to be full of this kind of inconsistency, which makes actually doing good analysis like this really, really hard. So I think this is one of the real grand challenges, actually, of big data, and it's hard to figure out how we're really going to build tools that solve this, but at least we can build tools that find inconsistencies. So that's one of the things we've been working on too. So anyway, you know, just to come back to these, you know, when do you know you have a big data problem? You know, the flight data obviously is a variety challenge. We've got these different data sets that have to be integrated. The mass general is also this, because it's all these different data sets from multiple different domains that have to be glued together. And I'm sure if we went and looked carefully at Jim Michelson's data, we'd find all kinds of inconsistencies like this too in his data set. I just haven't done that. It also has this human intensive part where we want to try and kind of take the human out of the loop. All right, so with that, I want to, you know, finish my sort of preamble with a little, just a couple of thoughts. So I often get asked, why is big data happening now? What is this that's, you know, where is this coming from sort of a technology perspective? So the first one is one that I have heard our friends in the three-letter agencies say a lot, which is the need for this, what they call predicate-free analysis. Okay, so predicate-based analysis is sort of the traditional way we've done science. We have a hypothesis, we go into our data, and we test that hypothesis using the data, right? And I think increasingly what people want are these tools that automatically find interesting things about the data, that tell you when there's a problem before a problem happens, or tells you that there's something suspicious that's there without you having to have had some guess that it was there a priori. So I think this predicate-free analysis is really, this goes under a lot of names, data-driven discovery, there's lots of different words for this, but I think this is driving a lot of the interest in big data. I already said this at the beginning, but the abundance of data is clearly a big part of this. We've got sensors, we've got phones, we've got web logs, we suddenly have the ability to instrument literally everything, and so now we have a ton of data, and what are we gonna do with it? And then finally, I think there's a set of technology trends that have happened. So I know cloud computing is as big a buzzword as big data is, but I think cloud computing is actually an interesting technology in the sense that it means that now services like Amazon, AWS, I don't know if any of you have used this, but you can go rent 100 machines for a day and spin them up and do some big analysis in parallel. And that kind of ability to harness computing power for, you know, an individual programmer sitting at their desk used to be, you know, a real challenge. It used to be that you had to go get somebody to buy 100 machines for you, and that would cost $2 million, and probably you and your manager wasn't interested in that for your little science project. But now the fact that you can go to Amazon, rent those machines for 2 days, run your science project, and come back to your manager and say, look, I ran my science project and here's what I found, is, I think, actually pretty compelling. And I think at least, you know, when I look at research and people doing research on data, I feel like the prevalence of these cloud services has really changed things, and I think that's likely to be true in industry as well. That's one technology trend that I see driving this. The other one is, and I'll talk a little bit about this, but next generation hardware. So there are some hardware trends that have happened. I'm sure you guys are aware of things like flash memory. You know, the fact that your laptop can now boot 10 times faster than it used to is sort of the practical consumer version of this. But you know, flash means that you can access data much, much more quickly. And there's some new compute technologies that have arrived, general purpose graphics processing units that can be used to do really, really super highly parallel computing. I'll give an example of that in a minute. And Intel and other manufacturers are now talking about these things they call many-core. So there's the multi-core change where you guys probably all know now even, again, your laptop has 4 or 8 processors that can process in parallel. This many-core thing is now Intel's talking about shipping devices with hundreds of processors that are either going to completely replace the CPU or augment the CPU in your conventional machines. And this is going to sort of even more parallel compute power is, you know, means we're going to be able to chew on even more data. So, all right, so that's kind of my little 15-minute intro. I'm going to talk next about some specific technologies and demos. Does anybody, you guys have any questions? Like, can I answer anything at this point? All right, well, hopefully my little demos will inspire you some more. All right, so I'm going to talk about 3 specific problems. I think hopefully you'll see why they're relevant. So one is a technology in the space of what I call private querying on private data. So this is a problem about if your data is stored in some external data repository, how can you run analytics? How can you run queries on top of it? Even while keeping the data in some encrypted representation. So again, I'd be curious to hear from you guys the extent to which you have these data sets that you view as being sensitive. But my sense would be that there's probably a lot of data that you guys have or might possibly collect. And I'm sure, like any industry, there's a concern about whether that data is, you know, being properly kept secure. So that's the first technology I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about a scalable visualization system we've been building that runs on graphics processing units. And then finally, I'll talk about a tool that's really built to address the Jim Michelson problem, which is, you know, why is there this weird pattern in my data? Where does it come from? So these 3 systems I'm going to talk about are called Monomy, MapD, and Scorpion. And I'll start by talking about Monomy. So system in our, when I say system, I mean a software system, a piece of software that does something. So I know systems is like the world's most overloaded word. So I'm just sorry if I use it. All right, so what is the private data problem? So you guys all know what this problem is, right? I mean, this is, you know, 2014, 70 million credit cards and PINs stolen from Target, right? So the problem is that we have these databases that are sitting out there in the world. They're storing sensitive data in them, and some attacker, or perhaps some malicious system administrator, or maybe just some incompetent system administrator, makes some mistake, and this data is becomes available to hackers, or, you know, is leaked out on the internet in some form. Okay, so this is the kind of canonical picture of what modern data, sort of web-based data system would look like. You've got some, you know, collection of users interacting with some application. That application is interacting with a back-end database that stores the information. All right, so how can we protect this data? What can we do about this problem? If we're worried about some malicious attacker being able to read this information, this sensitive content, the obvious thing we might do would be to encrypt the data in some form, so that even if the malicious attacker is able to get access to the database, the only thing they can read is encrypted data. Okay, and if you use the right modern encryption technologies, you know, it's going to be very, very hard for an attacker, even if they have access to the physical machine, to be able to make any sense out of that encrypted data. Okay, but the problem with this sort of this architecture, I mean, that looks like that's a very nice picture. The problem is that if we sort of keep the encryption keys on the client side, so the client decrypts the data that when they want to read it, the problem is that in the sort of the way you normally think about encryption, if I just treat the database as one big black box and encrypt the whole thing, the only way the client's going to be able to access this data is to ship that whole pile of data back, decrypt it, and then do whatever computation it wants on it. And that's not a very appealing approach if this is hundreds of gigabytes of data, because we're going to have to ship all that data encrypted over to the client, and it's going to have to do whatever it does to it and ship it back. So it kind of defeats the purpose of, like, having the database at all, right? So what we've been trying to do instead is to look at developing these systems that allow you to operate directly on top of the encrypted data. So specifically, we've taken this language, we've built a system that takes this SQL language, which is the common language for interacting with databases, and made it so that you can run queries directly on top of it. Okay. So the architecture is sort of, and we could do this with a surprisingly modest overhead. So the lead person on this work, I should say, is somebody named Raluca Popa. She's an absolute star in the sort of research community. She's just finishing up her PhD at MIT this year, and she's just an incredible person. So she really deserves most of the credit for this, but there's a few of us who've kind of hung on with her and are riding on her coattails. So so we're able to do this without making any changes to the underlying database, which I think is also pretty cool. So let me show you quickly how it works. So the idea is, so in order to understand how this works, I need to give you just a quick tutorial about how encryption works. So imagine that I have a column, for example, of salaries. So here's my table. Suppose it's employees with ranks, names, and salaries. And suppose salaries are sensitive. We don't want to expose this information. So maybe these are the salaries here, 60, 100, 800, 100. If I wanted to apply encryption to this, the standard thing to do would be to use something called randomized encryption. So what randomized encryption does is it maps every value to a completely random string from the point of view of somebody from outside. So it uses, but somebody who has access to this key can look at one of these random values and determine what the actual value is. Okay. So the mathematics behind this are a little bit complicated, but this has been worked out. It's been proven to be very hard to break this randomized encryption schemes if you don't have access to the key. The most relevant thing to notice about this is that even the same value, 100 here, actually each occurrence of 100 is a completely different value in the encrypted space. So it's kind of surprising that you can make this work, but again, people have worked out these techniques where you really can learn nothing about the data by looking at it. It's as though the data is just a collection of random bytes if you apply randomized encryption. Okay, so the problem with, if we wanted to run SQL queries on top of this, the problem with this representation is that, suppose I want to run this query, like select star from employee where salary is equal to 100. I can't predict what the encrypted value of 100 is going to be, so I can't go in the database and find the records that represent 100. So the sort of observation that we had was that we could replace this randomized encryption scheme with a very slightly less secure scheme called deterministic encryption, where the strings are still random, but that the value 100 maps to always maps to the same random string. Okay, so by making this little change to the encryption algorithm, now I can replace this query that looks for employees whose salary is 100 with a query that looks for this specific string. Okay, this specific random string, and then I can just bring those records back. Okay, so this is a simple way now that I've been able to develop a scheme that lets me run queries on top of my encrypted data. A natural question you would ask is, how much am I giving up by doing this? Because I've now replaced this randomized string with this completely random property with this deterministically random property. And you are giving up a little bit. If you knew something about the distribution of salaries, for example, in the database, you might be able to guess which record had which salary. If you knew that 95% of your employees made $100 a year or $100,000, then you'd be able to guess by looking at the frequencies of these random strings which one represented $100,000. Okay, so it turns out we can play this game and we can do lots of things, not just these very simple equality queries. So suppose instead of equal to 100, I wanted to find greater than 100. Well, it turns out that we can't obviously do that here. These strings are effectively random. But there's another kind of encryption scheme called order-preserving encryption, which, again, generates random strings, but causes those random strings to be, or if you were to sort them in order, they would be sorted in the same order as the original data. And this, again, gives up a little bit more security, but it now allows us to answer this kind of query, like greater than or equal to 100, using this substitution technique again, okay? Very effectively on top of our encrypted data. All right, so what if we sort of, and it turns out we can actually build up almost all of SQL in this way, but he's sort of using customized encryption schemes on top of the original data. So we've kind of gained this very, very cool property, which is that now we can go have our database, keep it in a completely encrypted representation on disk, and still allow clients to sort of run queries on it and get answers out without the possibility of, you know, some malicious attacker who owns the database being able to get access to it. So this means, you know, if you took your database and you outsourced it, for example, put it on Amazon, you could be confident that your data would not be compromised by, you know, Amazon or any of, you know, some malicious system administrator at Amazon, and it would still be in this kind of encrypted format. All right, so we did some analysis of this. I won't bore you with performance results, but the takeaway is that we're able to run a pretty interesting, complete benchmark of SQL on this, this is a benchmark called TPCH, on a database called Postgres with a median overhead of about 25%. So you don't give up very much in order to gain this ability to process directly on encrypted data. Okay, so that was Monomy. That was the most technical of the things I'm going to talk about. What I'm going to do now is talk a little bit about this visualization problem and hopefully give you a kind of a cool demo. And then we'll talk a little bit about this problem of the Jim Michelson problem, as I call it. All right, so this is a system called MapD. MapD was I developed with somebody named Todd Mostak. So the idea in MapD is we're interested in a sort of an interactive analytics problem. So in particular, this problem of browsing and visualizing really massive scale data sets. If you think about browsing, like imagine the example I'm going to give you is from Twitter. So imagine I've got 100 million tweets, and they're all geolocated, so I know where they are, and I want to put them on a map. And I just want to look at the data in order to do some quick kind of ad hoc analysis and understand what the data shows. If you were to go and take a conventional GIS system, like, you know, some of you may be familiar with products from Esri, like ArcGIS, if you were to go take that and you were to put 100 million data points in it, the system would, like, literally fall over. You would sit there and you would just wait for minutes for the system to load 100 million data points and render some map of it. And then, you know, if you wanted to slice and dice the data in a slightly different way, you wanted to search for something in the data, you wanted to subset the data, you wanted to animate the data, you know, good luck. It's not interactive. It's going to be this very kind of sluggish system. So what we're trying to do in the MapD system is build a really interactive visualization to allow you to extract patterns and insight from your data. So the key observation we had is that we can exploit these graphics processing units, the GPUs, that are in almost all modern computers, but it turns out that there are these new next generation GPUs that are really extremely parallel and good for general purpose computing. So what we're doing here, we're not using the GPUs actually to do the graphics part of this, we're using the GPUs to do the data processing part of this. What we're gonna do is load all of these, in this case in the demo I'm gonna show you, load these tweets. We have a SQL database that runs on these GPUs, but we're gonna load all these tweets into the memory of the GPU, and then we're gonna process them in parallel on the GPU. So the demo, in some ways the system is the stupidest possible system you could build in this way. What the system does is it literally loads all the data into the memory of the graphics processing unit, and every query, every operation we do on the data is processed by exhaustively scanning every, say in this case, tweet. So we're literally looking at every tweet to answer any query over this thing. But the point of this is these GPUs have so much parallelism and so much memory bandwidth that they can answer these queries in just a few milliseconds. They can look at every piece of data in just a few milliseconds. So we're really brute forcing kind of a visualization problem, and I'll show you a demo of it now. All right, so this is, hopefully you guys can see, it's a little dark. Is it possible to maybe dim the overhead lights a little? I don't know if that's doable, but all right. So this is the sort of MapD dashboard. What we see here is, here we're visualizing about 50 million tweets over a 1 week period in December. Okay, so what we can do is search for things in this data, like, let's see, hopefully the system is working. There we go. It sort of worked. Okay, there we go. So each of those little points here now is one tweet. I can literally click on these tweets and, you know, see what they show. So you can click on one point here and see the text of these tweets. If I don't clean it, I'll probably get my phone taken away, okay? So now we can do some kind of cool things on this, though. Like, we can look for occurrences of the word morning, okay? So this is like as in good morning. And then we can hopefully animate this. Oops, let's zoom in a little. So here, let me make it a little bigger. Come on, system. Okay. So we can see now, oops. So you'll see this daily trend as here, I'll zoom out a little bit. As the days go by, you see the word morning sort of spread across the world. So people wake up and tweet the word morning. Okay, so these are all the tweets where people use the word morning. Okay, so now just to point this out, every one of these frames, so we're animating this at 20 frames a second, every frame in this animation is being rendered by scanning every one of the 50 million tweets. Okay, so that's how fast the system is. I'm gonna show you a little bit of what we can do with this. So you can kind of get the sense that we can, you know, look at individual tweets if we want. But of course, we'd like to do more than just look at individual tweets. So we're going to switch to a representation here, which is a heat map representation. So, and I'll clear the word morning. So what the heat map representation does is if I search for a word, like let's search for y'all. Okay, so y'all is a word that's used in the southern United States. Okay, so. You can see these kinds of trends. So what the heat map representation does is it takes the frequency of the sort of background frequency of tweets in that region versus the frequency of that word. So even though there are fewer tweets in the south, and there probably are fewer tweets in the south with the fewer absolute tweets in the south with the word y'all in them than there are in, you know, the very dense parts of the eastern seaboard, the relative frequency of the word y'all is much higher in the south, okay? So we can look at lots of other trends. There's some other language trends that are cute, like wicked is a northeastern United States word. You know, hella is a West Coast word. And there, you know, of course, are things like brand preferences, like Dunkin' is a northeastern thing, whereas, you know, Starbucks is kind of nationwide, although more on the west, okay? So I'll show you just a couple of other kind of cute examples of the kinds of analysis you can do with this, because I think it hopefully gives you a flavor of sort of why having this interactive tool is really cool. So I'll show you one more example that I like, which is the word rain. So you can see when you search for rain, you can actually see these 3-4 day period, over this 3 or 4 day period, this is a storm that's literally moving, you know, sort of across the United States, and people tweet about rain as they, you know, as it's raining where they are. I think that for some things like brand preferences or sort of those sorts of things, this tool is really compelling. One of the examples I like, so this is in December when the NFL is happening. So there's one NFL game in this season. So if you search for Patriots, you see that lights up the United States, sort of the Northeast there. It's kind of interesting to search for, you know, one of the things that you can see with a tool like this is where these different teams' affiliations are. So you see that, you know, there's Jets, there's Patriots. I don't know if you guys, oops, I can't spell Patriots. You can sort of see there's the Patriots, there's the Jets. You can sort of, there's the Giants. You know, you can see where the affiliations for these teams are. So Giants are a little further south. You can see, I don't know, what's another team? You know, Ravens are down there. So it sort of lights up where people are. I like this example because, you know, at least in New England, there's kind of this like imaginary dividing line that runs through Hartford, Connecticut, you know, north of which are sort of, northeast of which is the, you know, where the Red Sox and Patriots fans are, and southeast of which is where the, you know, Jets and Giants fans are, right? So you get this like sort of these kind of separations between these regions. And I think this is the sort of thing that you can imagine it's really cool to be able to, you know, automatically discover where these kinds of affiliations are in this sort of underlying data set. So that's MapD. Hopefully you get the sense of why having this kind of interactive visualization is pretty powerful. Can we get the lights back up? Yeah, you guys are working on it. All right, so I won't say too much more about the technology behind MapD. I'd be happy to go into it. I think from the point of view of building database systems, there's some kind of interesting things about it, but I won't go into too much detail on it. This is Central Park. So one of the cute things you can do with this, of course, is find places actually really well, because, you know, people go to Central Park and tweet about being in Central Park. So the heat map visualization, this is, you know, it just lights up exactly the boundaries of Central Park because, you know, people go there and tweet about it. All right, so that was MapD. The third system I want to talk about, third idea I want to talk about is this system we call Scorpion, which is sort of, I call it why does my data look the way it does, but it really, I think of it, as I already said, as the Jim Michelson problem. I have this distribution, I have this outlier, and I want to understand where is this outlier in my data coming from, okay? So if you know, I look at here this example of Central Park, you know, what is the deal with this little thing here, right? Or in the Jim Michelson case, why is that one bar, you know, 5x all the other bars? What's different about the records that were used to compute that one bar that had 5x? The people who went into that bin versus all the other bins, and you know, you guys all threw out a bunch of hypotheses, but it turned out that the actual answer, at least according to Jim, was this, you know, sort of surprising result that it had to do with the doctor you had, right? So wouldn't it be cool if we could come up with a system that could automatically tell us, you know, what it is that's different about a particular subset of our data? That's the problem we're trying to solve. We call this the sort of why problem. Why do these outliers arise? What is common about the records in these outlier groups? Right, this is due to my student Eugene Wu, so he made me promise I would show a big picture of him every time I presented this, so there's Eugene. All right, so that's just to sort of make it concrete, specifically what do I mean by why? So here's, you know, suppose I have some information about countries, like maybe this is, I don't know, income by country or something, right? So if I look at this data, what we mean is, what we're sort of interested in is trying to, for some outlier that the user is interested in, what are the common properties of that outlier group? And specifically, what we'd like to do is find some predicate, some condition over the records that contributed to that group, that if we were to remove the records in that predicate, that make up that predicate, would cause this group to no longer be an outlier. It would cause it to look more like the other groups. Okay? So we want to find this predicate P such that if we remove those records that are covered by that predicate, the data set becomes more like the other data sets. And the way that this works in concretely in our system is that we've actually built a little visualization system, a sort of a charting framework that allows you to input your data set. You have a plot of your data, and you can click on the groups, and you can say this group is too high. I expected the value to be more like this. You give it some sort of general guidance about what you expected, and then it will do some analysis that will give you all the different rules that you might apply to the data to cause it to no longer become an outlier. So once you find this predicate P, you sort of want to talk about, well, what are the common properties of these records that make up this predicate P? So this is really the finding the fact that if you removed the set of patients who had these five doctors, you know, these three doctors from that last bin, you would in the Jim Michelson visualization, you would find that that bin became more like the other bins. So that's kind of the problem we're trying to solve. So maybe in the case of U.S. income, it's, you know, if we remove Bill Gates and Steve Ballmer from this, then, you know, we would get something that looked more like the rest of the world, right? And the predicate we would find is, you know, the company is Microsoft. Okay, I guess Steve maybe is no longer at Microsoft, but all right. So why is this hard? Well, so this, if you think about this problem, it's an example of an exponential search problem, because I'll show you why that is. So the idea is. So suppose we have some collection of records. So what we need to do is we need to search through all of the different records that we have, every possible subset of all the records, in order to find what the effect of removing that subset would be on the value of that output group. Okay, and so if you think about the number of possible subsets of records in a data set, there's an exponential number of them. If I have n records, there's 2^n subsets. Okay, and so I have to iterate through all of these different possible subsets in order to find the ones that, you know, in the most naive way you would solve this problem would require you to iterate through all these possible subsets, which is going to require you to sort of rerun some computation for some huge number of possible values, because, you know, in the case of the Jim Michelson data set, there might be thousands of patients or hundreds of thousands of patients even who contributed to that last output bin. So computing every possible subset of 100,000 is, you know, we're going to sit here for the eternity in order to do that, right? Even on a computer with hundreds of thousands of cores, right? So what we needed to do was to develop some sort of more generalized way of solving this problem. What we did in our research in the Scorpion paper, again, I'm not going to go too much into the technical details, but we developed these kinds of heuristics for efficiently searching through this space. So in particular, we sort of relied on the observation, our hypothesis that the records that are are these that make up these outliers are going to be near each other in the data set somehow. So we try and we find one record, the one in sort of a greedy formulation, this problem would be to find the one record that is the sort of most contributes to the value. We can do that by looking at all the records once. And then we, from that record, sort of search outward and find records that are near it and grow little predicates or grow boundaries around that in order to try and find regions that if we remove them from the data set would cause us to be able to eliminate these outliers. So we have a paper in BLDB about this. If you're curious, I'd be happy to kind of go into the more technical details if anybody really cares. But I think in the interest of time, what I'll do instead is conclude. So I think my point is, I think one thing that as sort of a high level point, a lot of times when you start thinking about software for quote unquote big data, a lot of people equate that with MapReduce. So, there's been a real trend in the world towards using these MapReduce or Hadoop-based systems. I don't know if these are things you guys are familiar with, but these sort of scalable computing platforms in order to process data. And I think that my perspective is that actually, as I said at the very beginning, we know how to build scalable data processing systems. We've known how to do that for a long time. Instead, what we need are the real hard problems in big data are a collection of problems that are a little bit different. And I hope I've convinced you that there are some interesting problems here besides just how do we scalably operate on large volumes of data, things like data security, as I talked about in the Monomy system, things like interactive visualization and data analytics, as I talked about in the MapD system, and things like sort of understanding where outliers and why data looks the way it does, as I talked about in the Scorpion system. So, I lost my last slide. Let me go back to my conclusion. Almost there. All right. I should have just gone directly. Oh, man. That was terrible. All right. Okay, good. I'm done. Thanks.
Okay. Get your questions ready, and we're going to start again with Stefan.
Hello, my name is Stefan Johansson from Sweden. I'm working with exhibitions. And when the few getting knows so much about so many, how do you think access to and use of big data will affect relations between the consumer and companies, or democracy and power in the whole world?
obviously this is the huge sort of the huge challenge around this kind of data collection around big data. I think I don't really want to comment on the let me say a little bit about the relationship between consumers and companies. So first of all, I'm a big believer in the fact that this data does have, there are really huge potential societal benefits to some of these things, that some of these applications in medicine and transportation, kinds of things we see people talking about, being able to really understand why somebody is sick or really personalize the care, medical care, or really do a much better job of, understanding how cities are being used or where traffic is. There are real compelling, I think, societal needs to this. So there's value in the data. I think the challenge, of course, is that there also is a potential for privacy compromises. And I think the and a number of other things, like your insurance company being able to discriminate against you because they suddenly have access to much more fine-grained data or whatever it is. So it is definitely something we have to be really careful with. There are, I think, two kinds of main ways that you might think about dealing with these sorts of problems. So one way that you might deal with these problems are sort of technological. So, are there things that we can do that will allow, and I think it's a great question, that will allow individuals to, for example, contribute their data in a way that's beneficial to them without necessarily compromising their own you know, personal privacy. And so there's a lot of people who are very interested in this sort of open data movement, this notion that rather than saying, you know, Google owns a bunch of data about you, that the perspective really ought to be that you own the data and you choose which data you contribute to which place. And I think in computer science, I'm a big believer in this kind of open data philosophy, and I think we're seeing more and more people sort of pushing this as the right way. And then there, you know, the natural question then is what can we do technologically to allow people to contribute their data in a way that lets them get benefit without having their privacy deeply compromised. And again, these have to do with things like trying to remove personally identifiable information, anonymization techniques, and there are technical solutions that in some sense, in some ways help. The of course, you know, this also has to be something that there's a big policy component to this. Like, what do we view as being, as a society, as being okay to do with data? What data is okay to collect and which data is not okay to collect? And, you know, unfortunately, in the United States right now anyway, it feels like people are not very, this is not an issue that most people really seem to care that much about. You know, I mean, it's people seem very happy to have their data kind of collected. They're not really paying very much attention to what data is collected. You know, the fact that your cell phone is always on means that essentially your cell phone company and as a result, probably the government essentially knows where you are anytime, you know, and people just, you know, it's like, they don't really care. They don't, it's not something that it seems immediately significant to most people. So I think as a society, we have to have this question, this sort of dialogue about, you know, to what extent privacy matters. So I agree, it's a really thorny question. But I also think, you know, kind of the cat's out of the bag on this one. Like, I mean, you know, the technology is out there, and now we need to start having the questions, answers about what we can do about it. So,
Manny?
Manny Janikram from Intel. Very interesting presentation. I have a couple of questions related. One is your presentation, your demos were primarily SQL-based. I was wondering whether it'll work with other databases.
It depends on what you mean by other databases. Do you have a specific system in mind, or are you...
For example, Oracle, or if I were to go use Hadoop and then try to do the same?
Yeah, so I'm sure it would work with Oracle just, well, I mean, so there's a couple of things. Oracle is a SQL-based system. The specific, the MapD, the visualization we built, I mean, it is a SQL layer that runs on top of this really high-throughput interactive database system. So if you were to put it, we could put that visualization on top of Oracle, but it would be really slow. Like each frame would take, you know, 5 seconds to render instead of taking 5 milliseconds to render, okay? The other systems like Scorpion and Monomy are pretty much agnostic actually to the underlying database system. They do work with a database system, but they'd be perfectly happy to work with Oracle. Whether this would work with Hadoop, I think the Monomy idea likely could be applied to Hadoop, although it really does depend on sort of knowing something about the structure of the data, right? So there are many data processing systems that are layered on Hadoop, and I actually think most people who are using Hadoop these days are using probably one of these higher level frameworks like Hive, which is essentially SQL on top of Hadoop. So if you're using Hive, yes, these systems will work just fine. If you're using a system like Pig, which is another sort of declarative processing system that gets layered on top of Hadoop, yes, they'll work just fine. Hadoop itself is sort of a lower level infrastructure that, you know, because it doesn't assume anything about the structure of the records, it is probably sort of hard to apply these techniques, if that makes sense.
So follow-on question is also, you mentioned the cancer data, it's a big volume, and also you mentioned it took months to come up with the variables, that the factors that matter, right?
Yeah.
I was just curious, was it a traditional modeling, you know, like looking at regression or looking at machine learning, like data mining kind of thing?
As I understand it, it was a very traditional kind of a, you know, variable, you know, sort of, it was this, you know, I talked about this idea of predicate-free analysis. This was a predicate-driven analysis. It was, okay, here's a hypothesis, let's test it, let's look at regression, let's look at the p-value or whatever, and, you know, do that over and over again for 20 different variables and until we find the one that's most significant. So that's partly why it was so labor-intensive.
Sam, Yossi Shafi. Let me ask you a different question. From the description of MGH, I actually got a lot less concern about privacy, because this seems so simple, so one-dimensional, one factor. The question is, would analysis that has no predicate would be able to find that it's only doctors who went to Cornell, who dated Susie, who don't, tied to a lot of other things, because this would be, in some sense, the frightening things.
Sure.
From privacy. For find just the doctor is a very first level.
Yeah, it's in some ways a very simple, that's why I like
the exam.
It's a very simple kind of a result, right? So let me try and tease apart a little bit about what you said. So I think there are a bunch of concerns.
Could you find things that are a lot more convoluted?
Right, much more intricate or convoluted explanations. And I think, you know, in some sense, this is what machine learning, modern machine learning, tries to do. There are lots of techniques out there. And, you know, the example you gave is an interesting one because it immediately smacks of what I would call overfitting. Like, you're learning models that are too specific. Like saying, you know, the fact that the doctor is married to Susie and went to Cornell. I mean, those things are almost certainly not I mean, it's hard to imagine that they could possibly be relevant, right? But it just happens, right? Well, it would be a surprise. But, you know, just because it you know, this is sort of like correlation is not causation, right? I mean, that just because it happens to be the fact that all the doctors went to Cornell doesn't necessarily mean that Cornell has anything to do with it. So this is one of the real challenges, I think, with starting to apply these kinds of automated analysis like the Scorpion tool that I talked about, because you're immediately in the space of sort of overfitting or over-explaining the data. And that immediately brings up these challenges around, you know, sort of what I call discrimination by algorithm. You know, if the system, if your insurance company learns that the fact that you went to Cornell, it makes you an insurance risk, that sounds like a bad thing for them to learn, right? You'd like to avoid that. So, I mean, you know, maybe there is a trend, but yeah. Wow. <It's> a little hostility there. All right.
Daniel Stanton from MHI. So, fabulous stuff. And one of the things that I'm trying to figure out is on the talent side, which we've been talking about, it's a different way of thinking. It's a different way of approaching problems. How do we develop a workforce that can think about predicate-free analysis? And how do we shift our own thinking from this hypothesis-driven research into, you know, start playing with the data and figure out what it's telling us?
Yeah, I mean, look, this is why you hear people talking about how, you know, we need to train data scientists. I mean, this is, you know, it's something that I think people are trying to do. They're trying to develop curriculum and trying to, you know, educate people as to, you know, what are the techniques that can be applied. So, I mean, I think that's the best I can say, that we're trying to, you know, educate a generation of computer scientists who can do this. And I think it's part of the reason why we look at enrollments right now in computer science and they're higher than they've ever been, much higher than they were in the dot-com bubble. Because, you know, there's this feeling that this is, you know, these kinds of problems are the ones that are, you know, really going to drive industry, all of the world going forward.
Graham Rahm from MIT Corporations Office. Sam, I really enjoyed the presentation. I have two questions. The first one is, when you need to deal with so much data, large scale, or big, we call it big data, obviously the trust is very, very important. I know there are some research on campus on that topic. I wonder if we can say something about that.
And can also, you say a little bit more? I think trust is one of these words that could mean a lot of things. So yeah, what do you mean?
No, I mean, more specifically, if you've done anything, or your lab or your group have done anything, technically, how to describe or measure trust? And the second question is, what kind of industry partners you will be looking for in the next 12 months?
Sure. So in terms of trust, So, the reason that I find it a little bit hard to trust could mean how do you get, you know, sort of this non-technical thing, like how, as a company, do you get your customers to trust that what you're doing with their data is not malicious or not, you know, going to hurt them in some way, right? So I think that's one notion of trust, which actually is probably relevant to many of you in this room. I don't really know how to say much about that. That's sort of the social issues of how you know, the best thing I can say is that I think for some of more technical people anyway, this notion of being open about what data is being collected is a good way to think about trust. And I think Google is an example of a company that's actually done a good job of this. For people who care, they will show you your entire search history. You can go and see everything that you've ever searched for. And in fact, you can delete it from their systems if you want, which I think that notion of being open about what data you have about a customer and letting people control which data is retained and which data isn't is a really, I think that's a great way to establish trust. And people are much more likely to trust you if they feel like they understand what data is being collected and what you're doing with it. There's a more technical notion of trust, like building computer systems that are able to protect data in a way that won't allow it to be compromised. This sort of systems like Monomy, keeping data encrypted so that you can trust that this system, no matter who has access to it, will not release data, right? And again, that's a very technical question. That is one that people inside of my lab or around me work on extensively. I talked a little bit about it in the Monomy example.
Can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
The visualization of the tweets that you showed, which is very powerful, can you maybe envisage how that could be applied in a wider sense? For example, Apple launches a new product and we track electronic records of purchases across the country.
Sure. So any, in fact, this system, as I said, is really a general purpose data processing system behind it. So it doesn't have anything to do with the fact that the data is tweets. I mean, you can, in fact, the system doesn't even necessarily care that the data is geocoded. But to take your example, suppose you have all the locations of all the, say, store Apple stores or all the stores where anything is sold, and you have some, list of all the products that are, the actual sales history at each of these stores. You could simply drop that data into the visualization we have right now and be able to interactively visualize it, right? And you could, in a more general setting where, if it's not just the sales of Apple products, but if it's, everything that informs the supply chain of Apple products. So suppose you know something about all the hundreds of suppliers that are contributing to these products, and you see how many, screens are being sold and how many, flash memories are being sold and so on and so forth. You could imagine putting that into a system like this and being able to see, a sort of a global aggregate picture of how all the things that contribute together to the sort of Apple ecosystem are being sold. If you couldn't, sort of provide some rough geographic coordinates around where those things are happening, like shipping manifests, for example.
And how far away is that technology, do you think, from commercialization?
Actually, the person who I talked about as leading this, Todd Mostak, is off trying to commercialize it. So he would be happy to talk to anybody. He's desperately looking for customers, actually. So he'd be happy to talk to any of you. Todd was a really interesting guy, actually. He was a student in my he was a student at Harvard. He was working in Middle Eastern studies, not a computer scientist by training. He showed up and took my database class, and we started building this system together. He said, I'm really frustrated because I want to visualize these tweets from the Arab Spring, and I'm trying to do this in ArcGIS, and it's really slow. So I want to build my own system to do this. And I said, great, that sounds like a great class project. Let's do it. And he said, and by the way, I want to do it on GPUs. And I said, that's a weird idea, but let's try it. And he built this really fantastic system as a result. So he was a Harvard student and then just a programmer in my lab for a year, and now he's off doing his own thing. So. Of the systems that I talked about, it's the one that I think is closest, actually, to somebody. If somebody is trying to make a commercial product around it, although he's kind of fishing for the right application. So actually, if you guys have you think you have the right application in supply chain or whatever, please, I'll hook you up with him.
Good morning, Sam. This is Li Jing. Used to be SCM 213. I'm working for Amazon.com. So great stuff first time, thank you. I have a quick question. A lot of stuff you talk about, I think is based upon the traditional database, which is a relationship-based database. But there is a trend that the database will be migrated, given the big data, it will be migrated from traditional database to non-traditional database, which I think Google is a pioneer in that area. So a lot of stuff you talk about, analytical skills, if we migrate from traditional database to non-traditional database, do you think there will be new challenges, or what's your aspect to that?
Sure. So, I like to say I think this is the best possible time to be somebody who works on software, data processing software, because as you say, there's a tremendous excitement about these new tools that are being proposed by places like Google and many other places. Every startup company in the world, Twitter, Amazon, PayPal, they all have their own custom database-like system that's not quite SQL, right? I think almost everything I talked about, when you go, take Google, for example. So they've got these systems like Bigtable, which is a sort of well-known system that they use to store structured information that gets used to do all kinds of things inside of Google, in particular serving of ads and many other things. If you look at a system like Bigtable or some of the more recent systems they produced, although it's not SQL per se, it's not that far from you know, sort of relational tabular structure. I mean, big table. It's a table of records, right? So anything that I talk about that applies to a table of records is going to apply to big table just as much as it's going to apply to SQL-based systems. So although I have talked about these systems as being sort of, you know, layered on top of SQL, I think this is the other question that was asked, it's not really much of a stretch to say we're going to layer these things on top of big data or on top of big table or on top of Hive or on top of Pig. And some of the work we do, in fact, is on top of those other alternative systems. I think it still is the case that SQL is probably the predominant language that gets used in the world of sort of business data processing. And but there's going to be you know, a proliferation of tools. There is a proliferation of tools that's happening, and it sort of remains to be seen which the winners are going to be, in the sense of, you know, what are the tools that are really going to last into the next 10 years? Are relational databases, SQL-based systems, still going to be popular? Is it going to be Hadoop or something that runs on top of Hadoop? I mean, I think we don't exactly know yet. It's still kind of shaking out. So, and the truth is, there are going to be many things that will coexist. So,
Dan Ford, MLog 2006 or SCM 2006, we're at Capgemini now. So maybe this is another presentation, but how do you see big data relating to artificial intelligence and, you know, robots? And I think we're going to hear a bit about 4D printing later, but
yeah. So so there's that's a kind of a complicated question, right? So I guess I'll start with a narrower version, then maybe I'll try and be broader. So if you want to constrain artificial intelligence to mean what I would call machine learning, which has essentially become sort of a statistics, like statistics on steroids or something, right? I mean, I think in that case, it's really clear what the intersection of the sort of systems that I'm talking about is and sort of these machine learning techniques, that you're going to have algorithms that run on your data, and those algorithms are often going to be very statistical in nature. And many of the things we talked about, like the Scorpion system, really is sort of a machine learning system. We've done some other things that are very statistical, like a SQL-based system that lets you ask queries on samples of data instead of asking queries on the whole data set, so you get approximate answers much more quickly than exact answers, right? Those are very sort of statistic, almost, you know, it's almost like statistics meets data processing. And I think that's, I view that as being really actually what comprises big data, you know, some combination of new software systems with these new kind of analytic techniques that glued together give you lots of power. So I think that's, to me, that's the sort of no-brainer of big data. If you look at the bigger question of, you know, artificial intelligence, like building systems that are quote-unquote smart or can do human-like things, you've seen data. This is not my research area, but you've seen these really pretty remarkable results that have arisen because of the availability of massive scale data. So you guys may have heard this term, deep learning. Deep learning essentially means taking a ton of data and feeding it through statistical algorithms like neural networks in order to get much, much better results on some classic artificial intelligence problems like facial recognition. So there's this new result that these guys at Facebook had, or a professor who just joined Facebook had, where he took all the images at Facebook, was able to use this data set from all the images, all the faces at Facebook, which has been labeled by people because they click on who the faces are in images, and is able to get like 98.7% accuracy identifying faces, which is as good as a human does. So we now have facial recognition systems that can do as well as people can on images because of the massive scale data sets that these companies like Facebook have been able to take and feed into their data. So in image processing and vision, we're seeing really kind of breakthrough results. Some of the other problems, you know, natural language processing, for example, as I understand it, we're still a little bit behind what humans can do, but we're getting very close. So these kinds of classic problems, classic AI problems like understanding speech, understanding what text means, these things that are kind of really are artificial intelligence, we're getting there, and part of it is because we have access to these massive, massive data sets. But again, those are, you know, maybe some of these platforms I've talked about get used in the back end to drive those algorithms, but it's really, those results are really very much more about the kind of algorithmics. And maybe you guys will hear, I don't know, is there somebody else talking in this space?
Robotics,
there's a robotics. Yeah, so hopefully you'll hear a little bit about whether this applies to robotics. I think, I mean, the sensing is something that has revolutionized robotics. The prevalence of the ability to put these super, super high throughput sensors that can collect massive amounts of data on a robot mean that you can have a robot in a space that can be much, much more aware of what's around it than you might have been able to do just a few years ago.
Professor Madden, thank you very much.
Sure, thanks everybody.
Okay, we're gonna break now and we'll be reconvening at 11 a.m. So just 28 minutes, we'll see you back here.